It's very impressive. And he was adamant, as always, about starting on time, so we're trying to honor one of his wishes. Bob had many, many gifts, and what I think we can all relate to, even though you knew him in different relationships, was his ability to entertain you, but teach you something at the same time. And I want to relay a little episode about that. In the 1980s, the development of the telephone answering machine kind of came around, and it was one of his avenues to entertain and teach at the same time. And so he often left voice messages that were interesting, long, and maybe intellectual or maybe random, but they always came around to a point, where you kind of got it. But it made you feel like you really had a connection with him. And so I'd like to take a minute and see if we can call him up and see what his message says today.
Got no free cakes, got no pancakes, God, this is my life, and I'm living it now. I got the sun in the morning, the moon in the night. I got my friends out there, and it's just a bite. I don't really like the wrong one. You probably know, I remember taking a chance, a bit of a swirl, but my God, I'm still picking. These masters come down out of the middle of the east, and they seen the roots of these glimpses of light between them. Shafts of light. That's rainbow. That's darkness of everything they have light. All right, God bless. Give me a message. God is in the night.
Hello, I'm Bob's son-in-law. I'm married to his oldest daughter, Anna. And he loves people. Is that Bob? I hope I'm doing the right thing. He loves Pink Floyd, and so we did a version of Shine On You Crazy Diamond for him at his 70th birthday party. He says he really liked it, and requested that we do a version, or do a version of it here at the memorial. Sartorial swoon. all the shadows of night and deliver us light. Shine on, you crazy diamond. You make everyone welcome with equal abandon, and you put our spirits at ease. Come on, you counselor, giver of foresight. Come on, you carpenter, you treasure, you husband, you father, and shine.
Hello. I'm Rick Stafford. I worked as technical director of the BHS Theater Club with Bob for 20 years, 10 years doing 20 productions. It was always Bob's stated goal to have each show we did be the best production of that play ever done. My job was to lead the tech group through the overall design of the set and the running of the show. When I took our ideas to Bob, he was generally enthusiastic and would incorporate them into his overall vision. But if he didn't agree with our vision, he would very sensitively say, "Your genius and mine differ in this respect." Well, the marriage of the arts, because so many disciplines come together in a stage play. This is ultimately wonderful and creative, but it can also lead to ego battles between different artists. Bob's response to this was, "Don't you think you are getting a little above yourself?" Generally, this kept everyone on an even keel. When Bob previewed scripts, he felt the story and characters had to touch our hearts by overcoming great social challenges such as persecution and discrimination. Whether the show had a happy end or tragic, the characters had to inspire us to be better people. And I think the stories inspired everyone involved to take the production seriously and do our best. If you were lucky enough to be part of one of those productions, you learned every line, every note, every cue. And you got to become close friends with wonderful characters like Anne and Otto Frank, Don Quixote and Sancho Panza, Tony and Maria, Mary Lennox and Master Colin, and who could forget the Pirate King. They became your close personal friends that you will never forget. Their stories could change your lives. The wonderful thing about live theater is that every performance is different. My favorite show was a production of West Side Story that we put on as a school performance for the freshman class. Bob was concerned that the younger audience wouldn't show respect for the actors, and he gave them a little talk on the suspension of disbelief. He said, "It's not TV in your living room, so you don't get to carry on a conversation during the show. So please have respect for your fellow audience members and the actors who've worked for months on this production. Theater is a give and take between you and the actors. So if you like what they're doing, please show your appreciation with enthusiastic applause. This in turn will inspire the actors to give you their best performance." At the end of the opening number, the ovation from that audience was terrific, and the actors came off stage saying, "Wow, they love us." They went back on stage and amped up their performance, and the audience responded. And that hour and a half was electric. The theater was suspended in time and space, and we all relived Maria and Tony's tragedy. And I think that on that one afternoon, we may have achieved our goal, the best performance of West Side Story ever given. In the summer of 1993, Bob talked me into coming out on the job site with him and Eric Van Buzikom and learning to be a carpenter. That summer, we were doing restoration on a Capitol Hill home owned by Phil Hosterman. During the first week on the job, we were sitting in the sun on the back steps of the house eating lunch. Bob was leading a discussion on an article he'd read the night before by Stephen Hawking. We were comparing Hawking's philosophy with other poets, philosophers, and rock stars. Phil had come out and was leaning on the back door jamb listening. After 15 minutes, Phil interrupted saying, No, guys, this is really all wrong. You're contractors. You should be discussing last weekend's monster truck rally, the Sports Illustrated swimsuit edition, and next weekend's big game. Instead, you're sitting here discussing Western intellectual history and the meaning of the universe. You're just too sensitive. We looked at each other and shrugged, and Bob said, "Well, that's great. We are the sensitive carpenters." And that kept us entertained for the rest of the day and pretty much for the rest of the summer with things like, well, what would the motto be? Oh, I know. Our handkerchiefs are always freshly washed and pressed. Or if you don't like our work, we'll cry. That afternoon, each time Eric or I climbed down the ladder to get the next piece of wood that Bob cut, Bob would say, "Good job." At lunch the next day, Bob looked in his cooler and said, "Ooh, I got a note, did you?" At the end of the summer, Bob gave us a party and grandly revealed jackets he had ordered for us. Embroidered on the jackets was Sensitive Carpenters with our individual name beneath. Over the years, other carpenters took my place on the top of the ladders. Bob would call and negotiate specific projects with me, like a deck over spring break or maybe installing some cabinets over the weekend. We always had a good time. Once in a while, he would call up and ask if I could come over to the job site for a ceremony. I would show up for lunch with the guys, and at some point, Bob would excuse himself. He'd go to his truck, open the doors, and crank up the stereo. Then he would put on Roy Orbison's "Crying Over You." Then he would solemnly walk up to the fresh young initiate, holding out their new Sensitive Carpenter's jacket, while we all would dab tears of joy from our eyes with our freshly folded handkerchiefs. So here's to my close friend Bob, endlessly fascinated with the complexities of the human heart, the wonders of the universe, and the original Sensitive Carpenter.
Friend and I waited at the bar. I looked through the window as a vintage green Jaguar pulled up. A man in a Marlon Brando-esque leather jacket climbed out of the car and hustled into the restaurant. My friend said, "Dave, I'd like you to meet Bob McAllister." It was all there, the tousled silver hair, the impish, naughty grin, the eyes brimming over with mirth and mischief. I remember thinking, who is this cool cat with the easy swagger? Who is this cheeky 60-something dude going on 29? Who is this Shakespeare-quoting, martini-swilling guy with a devil-may-care attitude? I was immediately hooked. All it took to get high from Bob was to be in his immediate vicinity. Face-to-face worked best. It was like the ultimate contact high. You were instantly hit with an overpowering sense of well-being, followed by a rapid expansion of consciousness combined with heightened sensitivity to everything around you. It was really groovy. Shortly after that first fix at the Island Grill, he and I began meeting on a regular basis for drinks. We talked about everything, books, plays, music, science, religion, politics. We gossiped shamelessly about our friends. We traded anecdotes about women we had known. No subject was off limits. One thing I quickly learned about Bob was he had a mischievous side. Case in point, one day, a few years ago, I went to the Virginia Mason Clinic in Winslow for some minor ailment. I don't even remember what it was. When I got in line to check in at the front desk, I saw Bob sitting up on the other side of the crowded waiting room. He also happened to be there for some minor ailment of his own. Anyway, Bob looks up, sees me, and shouts, "Hey, Dave, are you here to pick up your prescription for Viagra?" Anyway, it's common knowledge that one of the most insidious things about drug addiction is that the first high is always the best. That's why you keep taking the drug. You want to repeat that perfect first high. You never will, but you keep trying. But the unique thing about the drug known as Bob McAllister was that it worked in just the opposite way. With each fix, the high just got better and better and better and better. I became a hardcore junkie. In many of my emails and phone messages, I would actually say to him, "I'm jonesing, man. I've got the DTs. I need a Bob McAllister fix bad. When can I see you?" He would laugh, and we'd schedule a time and place to meet. But then one day, the drug known as Bob McAllister was taken off the market. The source had suddenly dried up. But I was still seriously addicted. I was frantic. All I could think was, what am I going to do now? How in the world am I going to kick the habit? Should I check myself into a Bob rehab clinic? Should I join BMAA, which is for you non-junkies, that stands for Bob McAllister Addicts Anonymous? And then one day, in a rare moment of clarity, it hit me. I knew exactly what to do. So how do you break your addiction to Bob? The answer is, you don't. You stay addicted. In fact, you nurture it, and you do that by incorporating into your daily life as many of Bob's amazing qualities as you can. Here are but a few. Be compassionate toward your fellow man. Be curious, never stop learning. Live in the present. Keep your sense of humor. It's okay to get into trouble now and then. Have fun. And when the time comes for you to move on, do so with as much grace and courage as you possibly can. I only met Bob 5 years ago, so I'm a relative newcomer to the Bob McAllister experience. I've somehow been fortunate enough to have lived a life in which I have very few regrets, so far, anyway. One of the biggest of those regrets is that I didn't meet the man sooner. Better late than never, you bet your life. Bob's friendship made me a better human being. I cherish the time I spent with him. And I'm sure I speak for everyone in this room when I say that my life is indelibly richer for having known him. And for that, I am deeply and forever grateful.
One memory of mine about Bob sticks with me. It's been almost 40 years now, I guess. Building a house out on Sunrise Drive. We were about 30, 40 feet up in the air on top of the wall of the second story. And it was a post going up from that. And Bob had miscut the notch for the ridge beam. So while we stood on the wall trying to not fall off, he shimmied up the post. We had to push him a couple of times to get him all the way up. And he, with a chainsaw, and he cuts out the notch, and he was fine. It was just what Bob did. You know. This is a piece I wrote some time ago about Bob called "The Iron Horse from Edmonds." Like those iron horses of the Columbia, Bob McAllister swept across the mountains from Wenatchee High School toward home, teaching Julius Caesar behind him, Hermann Hesse, Dostoevsky, and Catch-22, shaping his campaign to come on the third floor of that brick high school building, which fire reduced to a photograph or two and a footnote in some unwritten history of Bainbridge Island. First home was Edmonds, where he walked through a landscape of snow after the school bus dropped him at the wrong corner with miles to go, where he groped his first bra strap, where he quarterbacked the football team, where he dreamed of the university on Montlake, haunted by a dead father and a house of brothers. McGrath Holmes paid for college and built a journeyman to frame houses quicker than Seattle slough sired colts. He stowed the fodder that fed his vision, which defines poetry and passion and memory, where colleagues facing the wall of urinals discovered that taking a piss meant tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow comes in that petty pace from day to day, blah, blah, blah. He planned a house, first of many, that rose on Bainbridge, true and plumb as friendship. It grew from the muck as Bob built stud jigs, taught beginners how to pour, shoe, toenail, and sheath. He moved in, lost daughter Anna in a heating duct, fished her out, and found Nelson Bentley, the UW poet laureate, to read his poems. Bob, who became the mad priest of Bainbridge Island, lives on in Nancy Rico and Ralph Cheadle and John Davis and Katie Kent, the veterinarian who wrote a savage poem about a blue-winged teal, and all those poets Bob taught for all those years. He wrote a statement in 2008 for a BPA poetry exhibit that was put together by Nancy Rico, and a few excerpts from that. He had begun a poetry workshop in 1972 that quickly became almost a permanent thing. It's still going on, by the way. He said, I asked the students to write a poem. I believe everyone and everything has a poem to tell. I agree with Richard Brautigan when he said, every girl ought to have a poem written about her, even if we have to change the goddamn world to do it. This applies to everyone. Poetry is a way to view the world. William Carlos Williams said it best, it's hard to get news from poetry, but people die miserably every day for lack of what is found there. And he taught that workshop for years, and then he became too busy, and Nancy Rico continued it. He said, later, John Wilson also taught a poetry workshop for the Bainbridge Park and Rec District. Over the years, the ensuing tides of poetry on this island of poets who pursue the fretful muse have continued to swell. Part and parcel of this poetic flowering has been nourished by the San Carlos poetry readings at Lee and Marianne Jorgensen's restaurant in Winslow, San Carlos. Every spring, aspiring poets present their latest offering to the altar of the muse, while others listen, reflect, and know that inside themselves a poem awaits. That's the blessing of poetry, the need to speak the truth, to examine what's real, and to approach the infinite. Before coming to Bainbridge, Bob says, I studied poetry and was inspired by Nelson Bentley, who is a renowned UW professor and poet. During the 80s, Nelson and I gave a poetry reading here at BPA. That night, I described Nelson as the seed log, the one who nourishes other trees to grow. That description applies to the cedar, pine, birch, and madrona trees that grow on this island and become illuminated by light and focus and commune with the force that through the green fuse lights the flower. And typical of Bob, he ends that with, the quote is from a poem by Dylan Thomas. If you don't know it, read it.
On page 345, Thief of Hubcaps, Bob mentions me, then a co-worker is someone who whistled when he was in a good mood and how much he liked it. Like a few others here, I am a member of the Fraternal Order of Sensitive Carpenters. I have a jacket to prove it, not this one. It says Sensitive Carpenters in my name, Charlie, in cursive. 2 years ago, I took a job in a remote part of Alaska as a carpenter to make ends meet. I took the jacket with me, but it never left my duffel bag because I discovered that the type of carpenters I was working with were an insensitive, curmudgeonly lot who were dying to pounce on anyone who showed any sign of sensitivity. Now it sits in my closet, and I no longer wear it because I'm afraid of wearing it out. Bob and I met about 15 years ago. We hit it off instantly, like everybody does, apparently. Bob was, of course, not one of your typical construction guys. I had changed careers from a suit to a carpenter's apron a few years before and resigned myself to conversations with my fellow wood butchers of grunts followed by flatulence as if they were exceedingly talkative, then maybe they talk about their greater, who's the greatest endowed and biggest chick magnet. As you can tell, there was no competition. Anyway, all this was accompanied by a distorted, blaring, metallic rock, and then came Bob the Builder. Suddenly, while building a roof, I found myself discussing literature, plays, films, and poetry. We would break at 3 every day to listen to Garrison Keillor's Writer's Almanac and the poem of the day. And of course, the constant classical music as background. I was reborn. Before long, we were discussing our past, their similarities, our guilts and regrets, and our own personal faux pas that we wish we could take back or have a second chance at. That chapter in Thief of Hubcaps that I mentioned in is the last, and it's the story about waving goodbye. Bob was into waving. When he would leave his house to work in the morning, he would always wave to Mary or honk his horn a few times. He told me the story of that chapter long ago on a day when we were sitting in his truck waiting for the rain squall, inevitable rain squalls, to subside. And if you haven't read it, it started with him in his childhood waving goodbye to his mother before he left for school each day and progressed to when she was in a wheelchair at a nursing home and how, as he left for the day, he happened to look up from a parking lot and saw her strapped in her chair in front of a picture window and how the nurse standing next to her suddenly reached down, picked up her arm, and waved goodbye for her. He led me in so well that I was caught completely unaware, and I hit him. I was pissed off because he made me cry. He, of course, was thrilled. What better reaction could a writer, actor, storyteller hope for than the visceral? One day, about 5 years ago, Bob and I were working at Phil Hosterman's house on the island. He said he was going down to the library to do a reading audition for Island Theater and dragged Phil and I along. The play was Inherit the Wind, and I was hooked. My life changed dramatically, no pun intended, thanks to Bob. Theater opened a whole new world of self-expression, new friends, new questions about who I was and am. And with Bob meticulously picking away at my emotional armor at work, it took 2 years before I let him give me a hug. I began to see and feel things I hadn't felt for nearly 40 years. So he wasn't just a teacher and molder of youth. He was able to teach old dogs new tricks. In his book of poetry, Even in the Wind, Even in the Dark, I read for him my favorite, What the Wallpaper Couldn't See. As a good poem can do, this one struck a raw nerve of a personal remembrance. Afterward, Bob came up to me and said, "You get me." That may have been true, but I think Bob got me more than I got myself and spent a good deal of our relationship subtly drawing it out of me. I wrote a play for the 10-Minute Festival a little over a year ago and it was selected. I wrote it with my two favorite local actors in mind, Bob and Tell. I didn't go to a single rehearsal. I deliberately refused to listen to any of the inner workings, but Bob couldn't resist. He'd call me at work and he'd tell me what his character's background was and what he was feeling and whether he thought it was okay if he did this here or that there. And I just
love the way.
The night I saw it, they were both perfect. And they made it their own, just as I knew they would.
That was the last time he performed, and I take a great deal of pride in having had a role in its creation. I know he did it for me, but I also know he enjoyed it immensely. I'm going to play that opens tonight. It's at the Jewel Box. It's called The Games of Wood, a Mystery Comedy. Come by and see it. And yes, that is crass self-promotion. I did for a memorial service. But in Bob's case, I think he would like it. It's the first play I've done without Bob's feedback, and I do feel a little lost without it. I have a pair of Bob's goofy, colorful glasses in my truck. I don't know why. They've been there for years. I used to see them and tell myself I should drop them off. But now I look at them with fondness. I think they become my good luck charm. And besides, I find they come in handy as a reminder of where I am going and how I want to get there. Whether I have today, tomorrow, 10 years, 20, and how I might influence others to be themselves by example. I have another friend who, listening to me lament about not having the time to see old friends and acquaintances, said, "You've got to tend to your friend garden." I like it. Bob was a pretty good friend gardener. He loved to have friends drop by. He welcomed a crowd for Seahawk games. He helped found the Phil's Film Fest, a weekly gathering of friends for a night of film, dinner, conversation, revelry. He would call me if I had been absent too long, and he'd tell me he missed me. Yesterday, I stopped by the house to see Mary, and after I left, I remember I had forgotten to wave or honk the horn. I still need a little work. I'll get it right next time.
Love the way ideas and literature and art and music all create this amazing world that's beyond any of us. You want a cookie?
How many English majors do we have here? Okay, good, good.
At the end of the movie, we see Tony dressed in his mother's clothes in the police station, and we hear what he's thinking inside his head, and he's become his mother, and a certified psycho who wouldn't hurt a fly. My brother and I usually laughed at what frightened us. This time was different. We drove home in the dark. Not yet. We drove home in the dark and didn't say much. We went to bed because Tim had school the next day and I had to be at work at Edmunds Lumber by 7:45. But that was an amazingly quick transition, Dennis. This is the hardest transition in sound. In the morning, from my top bunk bed in the basement, I heard Tim make his way to the bathroom. I had an idea. After he turned on the shower, I took off the mop head, a long cotton string affair which I placed on my head, grabbed the toilet scrubber, wrapped a sheet around me, and stole into the bathroom. I knew the moves. Our shower stall was a cheap tin contraption. Not yet. I told you this was complicated. Okay.
Our shower stall was a cheap contraption.
Thank you! Our shower stall was a cheap tin contraption not attached to the wall. I placed the toilet scrubber in one hand, jerked open the curtain, screeched in psycho, and stabbed toward my naked, wet brother, who turned with his eyes open wider than I'd ever seen them, screamed, and threw himself against the shower stall as I kept stabbing. The stall almost fell over. Then righted when he shrank down to the floor as water poured over him. I stopped screeching. And Tim said, "God damn it, Bob." After that, when we showered, we each locked the bathroom door.
That the Lord began the creation on the 23rd day of October of the year 4004 BC at 9 a.m.
Is that Eastern Standard Time or Rocky Mountain Time? It couldn't have been daylight saving time, could it? Because the Lord didn't make the sun until the fourth day.
Yes, that is correct.
That first day, was it a 24-hour day?
The Bible says it was a day.
Well, there was no sun. How can you be sure?
The Bible says it was a day.
A literal day, a normal day, a 24-hour day?
I do not know.
But what do you think?
I don't think about things that I do not think about.
Do you ever think about the things that you do think about? Now, that first day, isn't it possible that the first day could have been 25 hours? There's no way to measure it, no way to tell. Could it have been 25 hours?
It is possible.
So you interpret that the first day recorded in the book of Genesis could be of indeterminate length.
I only mean to state that the day referred to is not necessarily a 24-hour day.
It could be 30 hours, or a month, or a year, or 100 years. Or 10 million years. There!
Are you trying to make me smell it?
I am. For even if you're shameless enough to deny your writing, you could not deny your perfume. Or are you proposing to deny it?
No.
Then you admit it.
Yes.
You sent him that letter?
Yes.
A simple, rank injustice.
What is?
I've got to say yard-long speeches at the top of my voice. And all her part consists of little exclamations like, "No."
I noticed that myself. You know, these short, crisp speeches, that are very characteristic of Sargent's women. You can't be helped, go on.
So, I give you everything. Name, rank, wealth, estates, honors, riches, two castles, and then you go about the place sending my cherished fruit to your lover.
No!
Did I tell you that Sandy and I have been friends since grade school? Even then, I knew that we would be together someday. Oh, and by the way, no one called her Randy Sandy and Easy Peasy except for you. Sandy was a beautiful young woman who was not aware of it and painfully shy to boot. You know, besides, you don't really look too well. Can I get you a drink of water?
No, thanks. I do feel strange. My legs feel so heavy, and I'm having trouble catching my breath.
Oh, that's probably the succinylcholine. I laced your fitter with it. In just a few moments, you'll experience a complete loss of all muscular control. So, anyway,
here's something that's true. Of the 101 major languages of the world, 92 of the poetry of those languages is in iambic pentameter. Bum bum, bum bum, bum bum. Beat of the heart. As in Shakespeare, when Romeo spies Juliet at night from his hiding place, the brightness of her cheek would shame those stars as daylight doth a lamp. Her eyes in heaven wood through the airy region, streams so bright that birds would sing and think it were not night. It's the rhythm of CPR, how to bring someone back from the land of the dead, the land of the living.
Fabulous freaks are leaving town. They're driven by a strange desire. Unseen by the human eye. Someone's calling.
Finally, you got it. You realized you'd taken out your shame at being caught with a beer by getting angry at your mom, who'd gotten you out of bed and made you breakfast. How could you have done that? Not only had you lied to her, you hadn't even taken your dish to the sink. Something caught in your throat. You knew in your heart what was right. You walked back toward the house and looked up at the front room window. Your mom was still there. You looked at the shape of her faraway, framed in the morning light. You held up your hand and waved. She waved back.
I'll be loving you always.
You waved again. You could feel a smile breaking your face. You waved again and waved until your arm got tired. It was call and response beyond words, but you knew what was being said. You also knew you'd get a detention, but it didn't matter. And something moved behind your eyes that mixed sorrow and happiness. You waved a final goodbye over your shoulder as you began running toward your school and left your mother alone in her watch at the window.
When I'll be there always. Now for just an hour. Now for just a day. Now for just a year. But always.
When I moved here just before the turn of the century, I mean the recent one, I'm sorry, I'm supposed to be using this. I found myself living next to Ralph here and Deborah Cheadle. Deborah was trying to replicate the Garden of Eden. And Ralph would occasionally find himself unhappily pushing a wheelbarrow, heavy with some plant food or other. One day I overheard him cursing his fate. I feel like the Sisyphus. This was my neighbor. He cursed in mythic. Well, I knew I was home. We've been great friends ever since.
And when, kind of early on, he started telling me about someone I had just got to meet, I was right away interested. Seems this other guy was a real character. Loved theater, did carpentry, and was a lifelong teacher. Not only that, he, just like Ralph and me, were born in 1941. I want to say to any of you who may have cringed at the mustiness of that year that one of the very, very coolest things that can happen in your whole life is when you're an old guy and you make friends with other old guys. You've done stuff, you're settled about how and who you are, and what you like and what you don't. You've learned more or less all you're ever gonna know about love. And there are the stories. When you meet old guys who love to tell their stories, that kind of friendship is the very, very best. Bob, of course, was the guy Ralph wanted me to meet, and I look forward to it for 4 years. I don't know why, I'll never know. But it wasn't until Kate cast us both in Inherit the Wind that we got to play together. I've told you so many times, Bob, how lucky I felt to have found you. You wanted to work hard, gave me so much of your time, loads of good ideas, took everything I threw at you with patience and graciousness. We tried our best, and at the end of it, we ended up fast friends. We'd rehearse in your workshop, mostly, once or twice in mine. We were both tool freaks. He who dies with the most tools wins, is what you said. When I say that we became friends, that really doesn't tell the half of it. Once Bob suggested that since we both had kids in New York, we should travel there together. I couldn't think of a good reason why not. And at the end of it, I was glad I hadn't. But when he showed up at my house with two identical metallic blue crew neck sweaters and suggested that we could have matching outfits, I blew the whistle. I hadn't worn the same clothes as anyone else since the goddamned army, and how could he think I might? But he smiled and let it go amazingly. I went looking for that sweater a couple of days ago, and I stupidly gave it away. Damn it. And the time he offered to show me how to build concrete forms when I wanted some walls to define our garden. For 4 days he showed up at a time of morning when I like to still be in my pajamas. He worked like crazy, taught me good stuff, and we had fun. I'd hear his voice from some ditch or other. Lords, I protest my soul is full of woe that blood should sprinkle me to make me grow. Come, mourn with me, for that I do lament and put on black incontinent. And then his wispy, snowy head would appear. You know who said that? Sometimes I did, sometimes I didn't. But I came to appreciate his prodigious memory. Truly uncanny, the lines from plays, some performed, some not, some taught, some not. You remember what Holden Caulfield does first on arriving at Penn Station? No, tell me. He was always the teacher. Of course, there was a measure of one-upsmanship, and occasionally I grew irritated by it and he'd apologize, and that was part of how we were too. And his memory wasn't reserved just for things written. It brought up so many details of things lived, moments of his childhood family, his brothers, mother, girls known, tendered, lost, and won. How I admired this amazing memory. It was surely the motherlode of the poems he somehow found the time to write. I am personally astonished at the things he found the time to get done. Even in the wind, even in the dark. That's the title of his book of poems. Even in the wind, as if to say, I can see these poems. Even in the wind when I can hear nothing else. Even in the dark when I can see nothing else. Hearing and seeing, we don't remember very well things we heard. At least not as well as we've said, at least not as well as the things we've seen. Seeing memories are sorted differently by our nervous systems, more to the linear, rational side. Hearing memories are less definitely stored, more to the instinctive, intuitive, irrational. It seems to be important about Bob that he called his book Even in the Wind. Sound was fascinating to him. He very much wanted friends to listen to things with him, things that were often mysterious to the friends. It frustrated him that his experience of the piece wasn't always shared. Bob, your greatest gift to me beyond all of it was the love that you and Mary reared in your family. When we'd go to deliver a bed, a table, a set of shelves that you'd made for one of your five daughters, I'd see with amazement the scads of other things you'd made. Toys, bureaus, coffee tables, on and on. And I'd feel so moved. The way the girls love and honor you says more to me than all the rest of your accomplishments. The love I felt in their homes is remarkable. And speaks so deeply of your goodness, yours and Mary. I think your last words to me as we sat in the sun on your porch looking over my newish truck were, you're going to upgrade the sound system. Well, I have, Bob. Better sound system, good advice. Even in the wind, my dear friend.
I'm Ralph Cheadle, close friend and colleague of Bob's for over 40 years. We often exchanged ideas and materials that we found effective in the classroom. And last month, several weeks after Bob had died, I was culling my bookshelves and came upon a copy of a short essay, Joyous Volodorus, Bob had given me years before. At the top of the page, he wrote, Rocco, we had these odd nicknames. Rocco, I use this in every class I teach. Love, Bubalina. In Joyous Volodorus, the Canadian writer Brian Doyle describes the physical extremes of the heart found in nature. That of the hummingbird beats 10 times a second and expires in 2 years. And that of the blue whale is so large a child could walk around in it without having to stoop. As different as these organs are, they all, and here I quote Doyle, have fluid, eternally emotion, swirling and whirling. No living being is without interior liquid motion. We all churn inside. As a poet and teacher, Bob demonstrated how words can give shape and meaning to that inner churning, that desire to break out of isolation and connect with the world. For Bob, teaching was a personal crusade against the Philistines of popular culture who devalue and sentimentalize human experience. For Bob, onomatopoeia was more than just a quality of poetic description. It was his bumper sticker, along with "Kill Your Television." Bob refused to retire. When he no longer held forth here at Bainbridge High, he took his message to the classrooms of Olympic College. Last June, when I visited him at home, oxygen tubes in his nose, he was writing instructions for his substitute at OC. Even in death, Bob continues to teach us. In a sense, our meeting here today is his last class. I'm his surrogate or substitute teacher and have in hand his lesson plan. Rocco, I use this in every class I teach. Because Bob couldn't be physically present today, I'm going to read Brian Doyle's concluding paragraph. In that, Bob wants you to hear how simple, exquisitely rendered images can lift us out of existential despair and connect us in meaningful ways with one another. And here's Brian Doyle. So much held in a heart in a lifetime, so much held in a heart in a day, an hour, a moment. We are utterly open with no one in the end. Not mother and father, not wife or husband, not lover, not friend. We open windows to each, but we live alone in the house of the heart. Perhaps we must. Perhaps we could not bear to be so naked for fear of a constantly harrowed heart. When young, we think there will come one person who will savor and sustain us always. When we are older, we know this is the dream of a child, that all hearts finally are bruised and scarred, scored and torn, repaired by time and will, patched by force of character, yet fragile and rickety forevermore. No matter how ferocious the defense, how many bricks you bring to the wall, you can brick up your heart as stout and tight and hard and cold and impregnable as you possibly can. And down it comes in an instant, felled by a woman's second glance, a child's apple breath, the shatter of glass in the road, the words, "I have something to tell you," a cat with a broken spine dragging itself into the forest to die, the brush of your mother's papery ancient hand in the thicket of your hair, the memory of your father's voice early in the morning echoing from the kitchen where he is making pancakes for his children.
As someone who writes musical theater, I started out pretty raw, and I wasn't as marketable as I am today. And Bob McAllister came to the Annex Theater. A lot of you know the Annex Theater, and are in the Annex Theater because it started right here on Bainbridge. Disciples of Bob and Dennis and other people started a theater that is still going today in Seattle. And so anyway, one of the first productions was a show I wrote, and Bob came to see it. And he said, he was one of the few adults that actually said to me, "Hey, I'd like to do something with that. Can we do it at the high school?" And I thought, wow, little boy goes to hell at the high school. Okay, now I'm in business. And it actually turned out that it would be a long, long time until I would be marketable. And he was still, year after year, for about 20 years, the only person that would regularly hire me to music direct these plays, West Side Story, Jesus Christ Superstar. One of the ones we wrote was called Joe B, because we couldn't get Jesus Christ Superstar. And I said to Bob, at one point, because we were frustrated, what do we do? And 2 weeks before we start rehearsal, I said, why don't you just pick your favorite story? And he said, well, I think my favorite story, if I have to decide, is Job, the book of Job. I said, oh, man. He said, no, don't worry, it doesn't have to be pressing. So we, every day, went at it, and in 2 weeks, we had the first draft of Joe Bean, which the students, the first song we played, we got a, kind of a standing ovation in the band room, and it was one of the best experiences of my life, and I think Bob's life too. And so when I knew I was going to play something from Joe Bean today, and I went to the keyboard last weekend to sit down to play one of the songs, and all of a sudden, for the first time in this whole experience, was hit by sadness and grief, and I stopped playing and I shook it off, and I went upstairs and I called Steve and I said, "What does that script say?" And he goes, Mark Nichols, Requiem. Oh, I remembered that we talked about this. And so the process was taking Bob's lyrics and some of mine from Joe Bean and translating them into Latin. And that's what we did.
Yeah.
A few years ago, I tried to distill what I'd learned from my dad into a single document, and I shared it with him on his 70th birthday. I'd like to share that with you now. I hope it's okay that I address him directly, just as I did then, because I know he's here in the room with us. Dad, I've been thinking a lot lately about the things I've learned from you. Not on purpose. An idea pops into my head and I realize or remember it's a concept that came from you. You didn't teach me these things, per se. In my mind, you exemplified them. From the outside, they look like some of the principles by which you lived your life. And obviously, I learned a lot more from you than these six things. But these are the ideas that have the most application in my daily life. And when I put one of them into practice, I think of you with love and gratitude every time. Number one, it's only money. Dad, you made a decision early in your life not to worry about money. You told stories about your own dad, how troubled he was after he lost his money, the long shadow it cast over him, and your vow to keep money in its place, not give it too much power. It's a vow you kept, as far as I can tell. I can't count how many times I heard you say the words, "It's only money." There's deep comfort and context in those words and truth. It is only money, especially when you want to buy a great leather jacket or a candy apple red Corvette. Number two, accept people as they are. Dad, you never seemed to have an agenda for the people in your life. However they were wasn't only fine, it was perfect. You always seemed more than okay with whatever was. You didn't judge. You never once told me that I was a disappointment to you. And when I mentioned that to you a few years ago, you said, "You could never be a disappointment to me. I love you always." There's so much comfort and security in that idea. I think we all want the people we love to feel that same sense of safety about us, that we will always be there, rock solid, loving, and accepting them just as they are. Number three, express love and appreciation openly, also known as make everyone your favorite. I loved getting voicemail messages from you because they'd inevitably start out with, "Hey Emma, it's the old man, ha ha ha, I love you." Or maybe instead of "I love you," you'd say, "You are wonderful," or "You're so amazing," or some other thought that was equally fantastic to hear. That's how you talked with everyone in your life. I grew up in a different household, and we didn't say "I love you" very much. But it's become a huge part of who I am. I say those words, "I love you," at least a dozen times a day. My daughters do too. You had an incredible ability to spread your love around, to share your good feelings, and make people feel special. I believed I was your favorite when I talked to you. I knew it. And I also know my sisters and many others felt exactly the same way. You just shined a light on people when you talked to them, and it felt so good to be in it. I'm working on shining that same light on the people that I love so that they feel celebrated, cherished, and amazing when we're together. I don't think there's a better legacy than that. Number four, speak your good truth. We were talking on the phone once, and I was telling you about the pressure I felt to get an important writing project just right. And you said something like, "It's going to be fantastic." And I said something like, "I hope so." And you said, "I know it will be great, and I always speak the truth." Speaking the truth is obviously something that can go two ways. It can be hurtful or sad, as much as it can be encouraging and happy. There are many truths you could have told that wouldn't have been great to hear, but you truly didn't seem to see them. The good truth was your truth. And when you said it and reminded me that you always spoke it, I believed it. How wonderful to have the people you love know that you see them in their best light and have ultimate faith and confidence in their spirits and abilities. When I speak my good truth to the people that I love, I hope that they will believe it too. Number five, aim to do what's right. Dad, you entered every situation with a desire to do the right thing. That's easier in some situations than others because life is messy and complicated, and sometimes even discerning the right thing is tricky. But you always started from a place of wanting to do what was right, not getting above yourself, with clear and honorable intentions. That is the same place I will try to start from too. Number 6, wave goodbye. Following what you learned from your own mom, you made waving goodbye a hugely important part of our family. It's a small gesture, but with so much meaning. It makes people feel loved, appreciated, and cared for. Waving goodbye gave us a chance to take a moment and take in our amazing good fortune to share so much love and connection. I will always wave goodbye to the people that I love. And as I do, I'll feel myself lined up with generations of my family. Grandma Alice, you and Mary, me and my sisters, my children, and their children. Just as you thought of Grandma Alice waving goodbye, I will think of you. I love you so much and always, Dad. And I'm so grateful that I've been able to recognize some of the amazing gifts you gave me and for the opportunity to share that understanding with you.
Thank you all so much for coming today. I'm so grateful to this island and all who've supported me as I stand here at the high school from which I graduated 24 years ago. It was then when I entered high school that my mom, my family, my rock-solid, logical, evidence-based mom, to me and so many of my friends, met you. Wow. I could describe your budding relationship in so many cliche ways, but what I saw was that my mom had her man. I was a bullheaded teenager who knew far more than any adult, especially parent figures. Acquiring you as a parent was not easy. You knew so much and were not afraid to butt heads with me. In Lit of I, the one class I took from you, I was sure of my interpretation of Dostoevsky. But you assured me that I was wrong. I'm still not sure exactly what I learned from that experience. But I do know that many of the things I hold most dearly to me are influenced largely by you. Once, soon after you moved in with Heidi and Molly, I simply left the house. I didn't say goodbye. When I returned, I learned that you were hurt by this. This really sticks with me. I never thought myself important enough, worthy enough, to matter to you this much. I would never have thought that you, the brazenly strong, colorful man, could be hurt by a teenager not saying goodbye. I quickly learned that everyone matters. Here are a few other important things that I want to thank you for. Thank you for matching my mom's fierceness and forming the most unusual but whole partnership. Thank you for giving me 3 sisters. They are really my sisters now. Thank you for yelling at me when I was 16. Yelling your love at me and hearing my return. I was shocked that you cared that much. Thank you for asking, always asking, what's your favorite math thing? And so many more questions. Now I'm going to read a poem that you quoted from frequently this past summer. It speaks of how you approach death and life. Mary Oliver's When Death Comes. When death comes, like the hungry bear in autumn, when death comes and takes all the bright coins from his purse to buy me and snaps the purse shut. When death comes like the measles pox, when death comes like an iceberg between the shoulder blades, I want to step through the door full of curiosity, wondering, what is it going to be like, that cottage of darkness? And therefore, I look upon everything as a brotherhood and a sisterhood, and I look upon time as no more than an idea, and I consider eternity as another possibility. And I think of each life as a flower, as common as a field daisy, and as singular, and each name a comfortable music in the mouth, tending as all music does towards silence. And each body a loin of courage, and something precious to the earth. When it's over, I want to say, all my life I was a bride married to amazement. I was the bridegroom taking the world into my arms. When it's over, I don't want to wonder if I've made of my life something particular and real. I don't want to find myself sighing and frightened or full of argument. I don't want to end up simply having visited this world. Thank you.
Papa, I'm so honored to stand here as your daughter. It is holy to me, it is holy to me that we are here for you, that we are here with you. How do I write for you? I keep hearing your voice telling me, be specific. Details. This is what you taught me. To see and learn and love with exactitude, but to do it while embracing the whole pattern of life and beyond. You taught me to live with the dark. You went into the dark with me and showed me how to survive it and love it madly. When I was 4 and I fought you for the hall light on, you came to my room in our house on Sunrise Drive and sat with me on the window seat you'd built and put our hands together into the pitch black and said, "See, it's only air." It's an image I keep, our hands together, touching dark. I love your hands, your big carpenter fingers that always slipped and hit caps lock when writing emails, which somehow always matched the Brobdingnagian essence of what you had to say, no matter what it was. There's never a shortage of exclamation points and letters from you. Everything I ever told you, you met with cosmic understanding. When I had twins, you were my light in a dark time of total self-doubt. You called me almost every day, or I'd call you up bawling, ravaged by hormones and exhaustion and dark, and you'd talk me through. You helped me grow into being a woman, a mother, showed me how to be a wife by how you were a husband to Mary. You came to visit me and sat with me while I endlessly nursed and rocked and walked your new grandchildren, and to lighten the mood, and because you were excited about it, you put on the DVD of you in the film Jurisdiction, where you played a murderer with half a face. The death scene. Hey, we're in the dark. Here's some more. I really love you for that, Dad. You let me be your favorite among your other 3 favorite daughters. My beautiful sisters. Thank you for my sisters. Thank you for Mary. Thank you, Mary. Thank you for the houses you built us to live in. Thank you for calling me Hides, Boomba, Bongo Bongo, Bright Star of Orion, Sweetheart, Darling, Skookum, Moonbeam, whatever words tripped off your imagination that felt good to say. I do the same with my children. On another of your trips east, we went dressed to the nines, hats and all, to see Madame Butterfly at the Metropolitan Opera. And we held hands nearly the whole time, and I will never forget your wet face in the dark when we looked at each other, both crying at Butterfly's demise. Pinkerton, Pinkerton. One more, and this is important. There was a night when you visited me when you had a dark feeling that wouldn't pass, and I remember feeling so deeply afraid that what I had to say would not be enough for you, that you wouldn't feel better, and that we wouldn't get out. I wanted to leave. But I did what I learned to do from you, which was just to be with you. We sat on the stoop and went over a script I was working on. We went to a bar and sat in the dark corner. You smoked, we talked, looked at the script again, a monologue I couldn't quite seem to get without pushing, which we both know is not the way to be the body, as you like to say. When your travel mate Dennis finally got back from the show he went to before saying goodbye, I ran into the Rite Aid to grab you some Tylenol, and when I came back to say goodnight, you put your hands around my shoulders and looked at me and said, "I feel better. I feel better." And we both knew it was true, and it was a trip we'd taken together. You showed me again on that night that you were not just my father, strong and always full of answers and words and a metaphor, but that you could go into the dark, and that I could go with you, and that we could come out the other side. All of us could come out the other side. You started talking to us about when you'd be gone years ago, joked about your will to whichever daughter got the first phone call in on your birthday or Father's Day. But in the last year, you said it was the parent's job to prepare his children for when they're not here. Well, we're all here for you, and for the love that we have for you and for each other. And I'm so grateful you taught me and taught us to love and live in such a crazy, soaring eagle, open-hearted way. I remember gunning it on an island back road with you, singing our guts out and pumping our fists in your truck to Sly and the Family Stone's Everyday People. I remember telling you I wanted to do my crazy dancing for you the last weekend I saw you in August. "Do it," you said. And I did. Awkward again in the parlor corner, afraid of making you laugh too hard because I didn't want to tire you out. But I know now that you let me do it for me, because I had no words left to say, but I love you and thank you. And sometimes the body can do what the words can't. I dance for you, Papa. I punch the air for you when I run to the ocean and hurl my gratitude and grief for you into the water. I see you in the contrails in the sky you told us to look for after you were gone, which I see constantly now. I see you as you wrote about, and I dreamt about you doing, getting on that horse without a rider, in the blue-black night, willingly, curious and childlike with wonder, agreeing to the next phase, grateful for what you lived here. And there is nothing left to say now, but I love you. I love you. I love you. Thank you, sisters. This is to my dad. It's been raining cats and dogs lately, thundering too. In my grief class, we went around and answered the question, what color is grief? Some people answered gray, purple, even rainbow. When my turn came, it was simple, black, jet black. You loved Roger Waters, everyone knows that, and used to quote from him often, "Even the smallest candle lights the corner of a room." I'm trying to find that light, Dad, that flame that was my father. You wrote in a poem to your grandchildren, two of which are mine, Harper and Beckett, "I like to live in a place where I can piss outside." Once last year when you would come to see Harper in her dance class and followed us home afterward just to get her safely inside, it's easier for me than for you, you'd said. She complained to us about having to go potty really badly. You and I gave each other a sly smile. Do you want to take a nature pee with Grandpa Bob? I asked. And just like that, you two were off, peeing at the side of the house, grinning like Cheshire cats. You made Harper's day that day, and every day. Mine too, Dad. As a kid, I'd spend weekends with you visiting from my mom's across the water. I think my third grade year was one of my favorites. I got the whole year with you. I don't remember much from when I was a kid, but I'll always remember you, tan dad, hammering away on the deck, Kitaro blasting on the stereo, the sun shining on your back. If you have the choice to go inside or outside, go outside. That's another line from your poem. When it came time to go home to my mom's, any time and every time, I'd run down the ramp that led to the ferry, screeching to a halt at each window and crank it wide open. I wanted to see your smile one more time, to feel your beam, witness your wave. I swear I nearly missed a few boats, but I just couldn't stop staring at my brilliant father. And brilliant is just the word for you. Brilliant, brilliantly clad in your hot pink jacket and turquoise sequin Converse. Brilliant in how you could quote Emily Dickinson or John Steinbeck, and brilliant how Shakespearean stories brought you to tears. Brilliant how you called your male friends honey. How you loved me and how you loved each one of us, even though I am the favorite. Side note. This year on Mother's Day, I called you and I said, you are my mother and I am your son. The next time I saw you, we snuggled in on the parlor couch and repeated those words. You patted me on my side and said in that beautiful, gravelly voice of yours, that's right, honey. And now for another excerpt from your poem. It's best to say yes than to say no. It's best to praise than condemn. If you sing a song and no one listens, scream it. If they still don't listen, play it inside your heart. I cried in your arms in July, releasing some old stories that only my mom and I knew. I didn't want you to know the tears, didn't want to dampen your red silk pajamas with my sadness. The darkness of the room couldn't cover our connection, though. You looked over at me, sitting beside your hospital bed, and said, you better get over here, girl. We talked and cried for an hour, and at the end, you praised me for getting in touch with myself, with what was real, and letting it out and just breathing. You said, doesn't it feel good to just be here together? What could be better? You are safe now. When I started going to friends' houses as a little girl, you and I devised a plan. You'd call me to check in, and if I was homesick and needed to be with my daddy, I'd tell you that my laundry needed to be done. We did this up until last summer. So you'd know if I said, I think some laundry needs to be done. You'd call back tactfully a few minutes later, talking directly with a parent. Hi, this is Bob, Molly's father. We have a family get-together that I completely forgot about. I'll need to pick Molly up in just a little bit. One of my proudest stories that I tell often and who all of my good friends, they've all heard it 25 times, is my coming out story. I'm coming out. I was so worried, so in agony, so stressed. You and I were driving down a dirt road on the island. You were visiting a construction client. I love to go with you to construction jobs. And I snagged the opportunity. Dad, I said, I have a crush. Deep sigh, I was really nervous. And I was married to my high school sweetheart, Mark, who's here tonight, today. Oh, sweetie, you responded, what's his name? And I just sighed. Oh, honey, darling, what's her name? After I told you her name, you simply said, I love women too, honey. Aren't they amazing? As a kid, Mama Mary would drive me out to your job sites for a lunchtime snack and hello. And I'd yell out to you from the car window,
You're my dad, and you're rad. You're never sad or bad or mad. I'm sure you were really impressed with my poetry prowess. But you know what? You never let on if you weren't. You praised me and my sisters. You gave us respect always. In August, when you were at Virginia Mason, I thanked you for never drawing attention to my physical looks. You apologized, said quickly how beautiful you thought I was, to which I responded, no, not that, Dad. Thank you for complimenting my character, my brain, my insides. Oh, sweetheart, darling, your soul is so stunning that it would be an insult if I were even to mention your physical beauty. He was a real jerk. I love that grin of yours, those twinkling eyes, the way you called my so-called boyfriend in fourth grade a twink when he stood me up. You loved words like Pumbaa and Shloopy and magic. Dad's magic pasta, Dad's waffles, some might call them Eggos. Dad's PB&J, Dad's burgers. I had the type of dad who people would constantly say, man, you are so lucky to have Mr. McAllister as your father. To which I feel warmth in my heart and maybe just nod, but I think you're right. You are right. You are absolutely right. I lost my mom last year. You were there, you talked, and you prepped us as best as you could, but still, I didn't know how hard this would be, Dad. Be strong, you said, be brave. And when I cried in your arms, it was you who comforted me. This is the way of the world, honey. I am not in a concentration camp. I'm happy. I've lived each day a good life. I wouldn't change a thing. And you know what? I'm always with you. And you are, Dad. I see you in the contrails as you said we would. I smell your Old Spice mixed with sawdust and Bel Air cigarette smoke. You're fresh from the shower scent, your rum and coke coffee breath, your fresh leather and crisp cons. I hear you tell me I'm strong and I can do this, I can finish this talk, and if I cry, that's okay too. I am, after all, your daughter, a Pisces, born the day after your birthday. Who can blame me if I shed a few tears? Who can blame me? I lost the best goddamn father in the meta galaxy. Your last email read, Dear Malls, I miss you. It's your daddy-o. I talked to a fellow teacher about this time we're having and my theory that this is for the best, and he said that the whole area surrounding the departure was a golden time. Much love, memory, and great magic. Love, Papa. XXX, oh, 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 oh. My father, my dad, my papa, it's you and me always, up to the stars, up to the cosmos, loving, living, and just being together forever. Thank you, thank you, thank you. As my wise friend said recently, it's not goodbye, it's see you later. I can't wait to see you again. We'll throw the football and we'll jump into the ocean and we'll share chili dogs made by Mary and lots of joy. And at the end of the day, we'll snuggle up in together, smile that smile that needs no words, and recall what a good time we had. We're going to have refreshments and snacks over to this side, so please join us. Thank you.
Good job, everybody. We've almost made it. I think before I go any further, we should give some props to Steve Stolle, who put this all together. My butt's sore, but I wish it would never end. This is great. I'm blown away at this day that we've all put together. Anyway, my name is Lucas. I am Ralph Cheadle's son. And Bob and my dad were teachers here at the high school. And they were like the cool teachers. And, I liken them to the Lennon McCartney, the Glitter Twins, the Righteous Brothers of English teachers. And Bob knew me since the day I was born, pretty much. And when I was a little boy, Bob would ask me, "Luca, would you like to play Rocket Man?"
Okay.
He'd get down on the floor on his back, and he would brace my stomach against his feet, and then hold my hands in his, and he would count down. 3, 2, 1, Rocket Man! And it would be a leg extension liftoff. In the living room, it was great. Rocket Man. So fast forward about 40 years, and I'm hanging out with my dad. We're talking, and he says, "You know, Bob is organizing his memorial service." And I thought, of course he is. My dad continues, "And he would like you to perform a song." Back in my head, oh shit. It's going to be Rocket Man. Elton John, I'm not. No. He wants you to do Kiss the Sky. Kiss the Sky. Oh, Kiss the Sky. There's this Jimi Hendrix song that he calls Kiss the Sky, but it goes by a different title.
Purple haze, all in my brain. Lately things just don't seem the same. I've been acting funny, I don't know why. Would you excuse me while I kiss the sky?
Oh yeah.
Thank you.
want to welcome everyone to stay for refreshments, and if you could, if you're inclined, sign the memory books up there and the memory wall as well. We also found a ring and a hoop earring, so get those. Thank you so much, everyone.